Good morning, everybody. Welcome to Fellowship of the Word. Happy Sabbath. It is July 11th, 2020, and we're going to start out with a call to worship called Praise Him, Praise Him. Praise Him, praise Him, Jesus, our blessed Redeemer. Sing, O earth, His wonderful love proclaim. Hail Him, highest of angels in glory. Strength and honor give to His holy name. Like a shepherd, Jesus will guard His children. In His arms, He carries them all day long. His excellent greatness. Praise Him, praise Him, ever in joyful song. Praise Him, praise Him, Jesus our blessed Redeemer. For our sins He suffered and bled and died. He our rock, our hope of eternal salvation. Hail Him, Jesus and glorified. Sound His praises, Jesus who bore.
Happy Sabbath, everybody.
Good morning. Good morning.
We've been singing the song Seasons, that Turn, Turn, Turn by the Birds. I've always loved that passage. So I went to Ecclesiastes 3, and I read through it, and I went on, and I read the whole chapter. And when you read the whole thing, it's like, it's so powerful, and it just kind of, I don't know, it just gave me some more insight into what it really means for us, especially in our time. To everything there is a season, and a time for every purpose under the heavens. A time to be born, a time to die, a time to plant, and a time to pluck up what is planted. A time to kill, and a time to heal. A time to break down, and a time to build up. A time to weep, and a time to laugh. A time to mourn, and a time to dance. A time to throw away stones, and a time to gather stones together. A time of embrace, and a time to refrain from embracing. A time to gain, and a time to lose. A time to keep, and a time to throw away. A time to tear, and a time to sow. A time to keep silence, and a time to speak. A time to love, and a time to hate. A time of war, and a time of peace. And that's basically what the song is, and I'm going to continue on, starting with verse 9. What profit does he have who works in that in which he labors? I have seen the task which God has given to the sons of men to be exercised by it. He has made everything beautiful in its time. He has also set eternity in their heart so that no man can find out the work that God makes from the beginning to the end. And I had to read that over myself several times. I get it. We don't know the works of God completely. And we don't in this, not in this life. And we can appreciate that. I know that nothing is better for them than to rejoice and to do good as long as they live. And also every man should eat and drink and enjoy the good of all his labor. It is the gift of God. I know that whatever God does, it shall be forever. Nothing can be added to it, nor nothing taken away from it. And God does it so that men should fear before him that which has been is now, that which is to be has already been, and God requires an account of that which is past. I just think of that old expression we've all heard, there's nothing new under the sun. If you think about it, that just jumped out at me. I mean, you know. And again, I saw under the sun a place of judgment. That wickedness was there, and in the place of righteousness, that wickedness was there. And I said in my heart, God shall judge the righteous and the wicked. For there is a time there for every purpose and every work. I said in my heart, concerning the matter of the sons of men, may God reveal to them that they may see what they themselves are but beasts. For that which happens to the sons of men also happens to beasts. Even one thing happens to them as the one dies. So dies the other. Yea, they all have one breath, so that a man has no advantage over a beast. For all is vanity. Here's another passage. Stop and think about it and read it again. Now, that's not saying that we're made the same as the beast of the earth, because God has set us aside in his image. And we understand that as God's people. All go to one place. All are of the dust. And all return to dust again. Who knows the spirit of man whether it goes upward, and the spirit of the beast whether it goes downward to the earth? Therefore I perceive that there is nothing better that a man should do than to rejoice in his own works. For that is his portion. For who can bring him to see what shall be after him? Does anybody here know what's going to come after we're gone? We don't know. We don't know. Some of us might be alive when things start to really come together, but I believe most of us are going to be in the ground. We'll be asleep. And then to close, I found this. I kept reading down. As often happens, I just start and I get on, you know, I just start taking all this stuff in. Go to Ecclesiastes 9, and I'm going to read verses 17 and 18. I think it's the last two verses of that chapter. The quiet words of the wise are more to be heeded than the shouts of a ruler among fools. Wisdom is better than weapons of war, but one sinner destroys much good. Chew on that one. Thank you.
The title of this message is Seals 5 through 7. We covered the first four seals in the previous presentation, entitled Love Waxing Cold and the Four Horsemen, which explores the potential of their being opened by Jesus Christ, Yeshua Messiah, at the moment of his ascension to the Father on the day of first fruits. And from that point onward, all of the calamities described in them, which have already existed in the world, would begin to grow exponentially worse as time goes on. Regardless whether one views these seals to have been opened at a later time or have yet to be opened, we can certainly agree that all such events are nothing new and that they will only increase in frequency and severity as the very last days approach. However, the following seals more clearly begin to make references to events which will occur at some point in the future. This is the fifth seal, Cry of the Martyrs, Revelation 6, starting in verse 9. When he opened the fifth seal, I saw under the altar the souls of those who had been slain for the word of God and for the testimony which they held. And they cried with a loud voice, saying, How long, O Lord, holy and true, until you judge and avenge our blood on those who dwell on the earth? Then a white robe was given to each of them, and it was said to them that they should rest a little while longer, until both the number of their fellow servants and the brethren, who would be killed as they were, was completed. The first aspect questioned by nearly anyone among our church culture regarding this part of John's vision is how these dead souls martyred for their Christian testimony could possibly speak when they have not yet been raised from the dead in the first resurrection. The text appears to suggest that these who died in Christ are waiting for his return in some form of restless anguish, rather than resting in peace. However, is this section really meant to be entirely literal? Consider the following scripture, Genesis 4 and verse 10. And he said to Cain, What have you done? The voice of your brother's blood cries out to me from the ground. It's obvious here that Abel's blood wasn't literally crying out from the ground, as blood cannot speak. Therefore, this must be metaphorical. The white robes given to them in this metaphorical vision is a sign of their already having been washed by the blood of the Lamb. It then speaks of there being more martyrs to follow into the future. We understand based upon various scriptures that all deceased humans are currently unconscious and awaiting their appointed resurrection. Those who died in Christ at the first unto a spiritual body, otherwise at the second unto a physical body prior to the first day of judgment. The first resurrection occurs at the time of Messiah's return to set up his millennial kingdom here upon the earth. Therefore, these souls already martyred for their Christian faith would not yet be alive to speak. I submit that this portion of John's vision is not meant for us to interpret as being literal, but rather to illustrate that just as the other calamities written of in the first four seals had occurred since the fall of humankind from the Garden of Eden, martyrdom has been likewise. Further, it does in fact appear that martyrdom for being a follower of Yeshua Messiah, Jesus Christ, has greatly increased in both frequency and severity over the last couple of millennia. And after all, it wasn't until he came in the flesh and was sacrificed as our Passover lamb who washes away the sins of the entire world that this gospel message was preached to the entire world, thus exponentially increasing the accounts of martyrdom for the faith. All this taken into consideration, as with the previous seals, it might be that this fifth seal was also opened at the time of Christ's ascension on the day of first fruits, which has caused the frequency and severity of Christian martyrdom to exponentially increase ever since. Thus far, every single seal has spoken of calamitous events which have been going on throughout the history of humankind. The sixth seal is the very first in this succession, which does not. So let's cover the sixth seal, which includes cosmic disturbances. Starting in Revelation 6, verse 12. I looked when he opened the sixth seal, and behold, there was a great earthquake, and the sun became black as sackcloth of hair, and the moon became like blood. And the stars of heaven fell to the earth as a fig tree drops its late figs when it is shaken by a mighty wind. Then the sky receded as a scroll when it is rolled up, and every mountain and island was moved out of its place. And the kings of the earth, the great men, the rich men, the commanders, the mighty men, and every slave and every free man hid themselves in the caves and in the rocks of the mountains, and said to the mountains and the rocks, Fall on us and hide us from the face of him who sits on the throne and from the wrath of the Lamb. For the great day of his wrath has come, and who is able to stand? This seal is often referred to as the day of the Lord, when Messiah returns to set up his millennial kingdom. However, Verse 12 states that the sun became black as sackcloth of hair, and the moon became like blood. According to Joel, this happens before the day of the Lord. Let's read in Joel 2, verse 31. The sun shall be turned into darkness and the moon into blood before the coming of the great and awesome day of the Lord. Further, consider that Revelation 6, 15 through 16 speaks of kings, princes, generals, and various other mighty rich and lowly poor hiding underground. This doesn't sound like the Battle of Armageddon, which, when considering the sixth bowl, which occurs after the succession of seals and trumpets. Let's read over there in Revelation 16, starting in verse 12. Then the sixth angel poured out his bowl on the great river Euphrates, and its water was dried up, so that the way of the kings from the east might be prepared. And I saw three unclean spirits like frogs coming out of the mouth of the dragon, out of the mouth of the beast, and out of the mouth of the false prophet. For they are the spirits of demons performing signs, which go out to the kings of the earth and of the whole world to gather them to the battle of that great day of God Almighty. Behold, I am coming as a thief. Blessed is he who watches and keeps his garments, lest he walk naked and they see his shame. And they gathered them together to the place called in Hebrew Armageddon. Further, consider the following. In Revelation 19, 17 through 19, then I saw an angel standing in the sun, and he cried with a loud voice, saying to all the birds that fly in the midst of heaven, come and gather together for the supper of the great God, that you may eat the flesh of kings, the flesh of captains, the flesh of mighty men, the flesh of horses, and of those who sit on them, and the flesh of all people, free and slave, both small and great. And I saw the beast, the kings of the earth, and their armies, gathered together to make war against him who sat on the horse and against his army. So all this makes it fairly clear that the sixth seal is not the day of the Lord. Although Revelation 6, verse 17 might appear to suggest this, saying the great day of his wrath has come, and who is able to stand? However, the Greek word translated as day is hemera, if I'm pronouncing that anywhere near correctly, which can mean a time period rather than a literal day. Thus, could also be interpreted as, for the great time of his wrath has come. Taking all this into consideration, it appears that the sixth seal speaks only of a future time, from both John's perspective and our own, when the entire planet will shake due to massive earthquakes and meteor impacts, referencing every mountain and island being moved and the stars of heaven falling to earth. This is certainly to be a global event which appears to be recognized by nearly everyone as a sort of announcement that our Lord and King is about to return. It is suggested by some that Revelation chapter 7 breaks from the succession of the seven seals of the scroll, which are being opened by Messiah. However, I find nothing specific within the text which appears to suggest this, and therefore I view its contents to be part of the sixth seal. Revelation 7, verse 1. After these things I saw four angels standing at the four corners of the earth, holding the four winds of the earth, that the wind should not blow on the earth, on the sea, or on any tree. Then I saw another angel ascending from the east, having the seal of the living God. And he cried with a loud voice to the four angels, to whom it was granted to harm the earth and the sea, saying, do not harm the earth, the sea, or the trees, till we have sealed the servants of our God on their foreheads. And I heard the number of those who were sealed. 144,000 of all the tribes of the children of Israel were sealed. I'm going to paraphrase here. 12,000 from each tribe, Judah, Reuben, Gad, Asher, Naphtali, Manasseh, Simeon, Levi, Issachar, I don't know how to pronounce that one, Zebulun, Joseph, and Benjamin. This seal of the living God should not be confused with the opening of the seven seals, which sealed the scroll taken by Messiah from the hand of the Father, sitting upon the throne as described in Revelation 5:1. This is apparently a seal of protection, which is placed upon the foreheads of the servants of God. Having just previously read about the cosmic calamity to fall upon the entire planet, it would seem more effective for such a seal of protection over God's servants to be applied prior to such events, which would certainly destroy many lives. Could it be that these four angels holding back the four winds of the earth are the very ones who carry out the effects of the sixth seal, and that this vision was perhaps given slightly out of chronological order? It certainly appears this way, considering the following verses. And we'll continue on, Revelation 7, starting in 9. After these things I looked, and behold, a great multitude which no one could number, of all nations, tribes, peoples, and tongues, standing before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed with white robes, with palm branches in their hands, and crying out with a loud voice, saying, "Salvation belongs to our God who sits on the throne, and to the Lamb." All the angels stood around the throne, and the elders, and the four living creatures, and fell on their faces before the throne, and worshipped God, saying, "Amen, blessing and glory and wisdom, thanksgiving and honor and power and might be to our God forever and ever. Amen." And by the way, in my computer Bible, that was given in verse form. In other words, that was given as if it was a song being sung by the four living creatures, the elders and such. And it's interesting to me, every time I read a new song, so to speak, or what appears to be a song in Revelation, I keep thinking, a new song. I just keep thinking, they're singing a new song. Why is it new? Because Christ hasn't done what he's doing right now in any time in the past. So it's kind of interesting to me that when I come across a verse like this in Revelation where these beings are giving worship to the Lamb especially, that it is really a new song each time they do that, because there's something new going on here that's never happened in the entire existence of the Father and the Son or anyone. Continuing on here in verse 13, "Then one of the elders answered, saying to me, 'Who are these arrayed in white robes, and where do they come from?' And I said to him, 'Sir, you know.' So he said to me, 'These are the ones who come out of the great tribulation and washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. Therefore, they are before the throne of God and serve him day and night in his temple. And he who sits on the throne will dwell among them. They shall neither hunger any more nor thirst any more. The sun shall not strike them, nor any heat. For the Lamb who is in the midst of the throne will shepherd them and lead them to living fountains of waters. And God will wipe away every tear from their eyes.'" Here John is given what appears to be a vision of all God's people throughout time who have made their robes white through the blood of the Lamb. The last portion of this segment of Scripture appears to be identically parallel with those found in Revelation 21 and 22. Considering that the Great Tribulation has not yet, or at least not yet fully, occurred, and Christ has not returned, this must be an event which occurs later, but was given to John in advance. Likewise, it stands to reason that the sealing of God's servants as part of the sixth seal occurred prior to the cosmic calamities, and this vision is simply not given specifically in precise chronological order. Moving on to the seventh seal, the prelude to the seven trumpets. Revelation 8, starting in verse 1. "When he opened the seventh seal, there was silence in heaven for about half an hour. And I saw the seven angels who stand before God, and to them were given seven trumpets. Then another angel, having a golden censer, came and stood at the altar. He was given much incense, that he should offer it with the prayers of all the saints upon the golden altar, which was before the throne. And the smoke of the incense with the prayers of the saints ascended before God from the angel's hand. Then the angel took the censer, filled it with fire from the altar, and threw it to the earth. and there were noises, thunderings, lightnings, and an earthquake. So the seven angels who had the seven trumpets prepared themselves to sound. The opening of the seventh seal begins with silence in heaven for what appears to be a short period of time. It has been reasoned by some that this silence in heaven parallels the metaphor of God slamming his gavel down, perhaps the earthquakes and meteors which occurred from the sixth seal, which just happened just prior to this, as if to say, order in the court, just prior to rendering his judgments upon the earth, which are about to come in the form of trumpets sounding, announcing the declaration of each judgment. I kind of tend to believe this, actually. It's an interesting concept I haven't necessarily heard before, but it kind of makes sense. What would God's gavel sound like but cosmic disturbances to the likes that no one has ever felt, heard, or witnessed before, right? It's an interesting concept. In contrast to all the seals of the scroll having been opened by Christ, the only one worthy and able to do so, here we see seven angels are given the seven trumpets to sound. As they prepared to do so, another angel having a golden censer with much incense stood at the golden altar of God to offer it along with the prayers of all the saints. Directly afterwards, this angel fills the censer with fire from the altar and throws it to the earth, which creates thunderings, lightnings, and an earthquake. I wonder, this whole thing about the incense is interesting to me. There are some scriptures where God talks about bringing up past sins over and over is like a stench to him. So I'm kind of thinking that maybe somehow the incense makes that smell a little better to God. I don't know. All right, so he fills the censer. Now, presumably, it's done burning the incense, this offering of the prayers of the sins of all the saints. When that comes to an end, he fills the censer with fire, throws it to the earth, which creates, again, thunderings, lightnings, and an earthquake, which sounds similar to the sixth seal, but I think it's something different here, slightly different, because it doesn't talk about meteors or stars falling and that sort of thing yet. And it talks about an earthquake, where in the sixth seal, the whole earth seems to shake and mountains and islands moving out of place. So it seems like there's something slightly different between the two. While lives and natural resources were certainly lost during the global earthquakes and meteor showers of the sixth seal, those scriptures never make specific mention of the extent of this devastation. However, as the trumpets begin to sound, the devastation conveyed is massive, destroying one-third of vegetation, sea life, fresh water and rivers and lakes, heavenly bodies, and then human life. So each trumpet going forward, and we're not going to cover that today, but each trumpet coming forward is super devastating as compared to the sixth seal, it appears to be. Anyway, again, we're not going to go there right now. But this seems like a very different thing happening here. The trumpets are major, major devastation. So it could be reasoned that the sixth seal marks the beginning of the Great Tribulation. However, perhaps the Great Tribulation begins with the sounding of the first trumpet, after the gavel, so to speak, perhaps. Either way, these scriptures make it fairly certain that the Great Tribulation hasn't yet begun. I think that's a lot of the point of this entire study. The reason why I started studying this is largely, as I shared last time in the first part of the study, is that, you know, there's a lot of concern right now with different things going on that are unprecedented in my lifetime. Whether or not certain seals had been opened recently, or which ones, these types of things. I don't think I've heard anybody suggest that trumpets have started blowing. I think we would tend to recognize that, because I think no one's gonna not recognize, according to the Bible, according to the scriptures that we just read about the sixth seal. It talks about pretty much almost everybody recognizing, hey, this is major and something's coming from God here. Whether or not they fully understand what's going to happen, I don't know. I tend to believe that, well, if we as children of God recognize these things, why would we hide from God? Other than perhaps try to protect ourselves from being crushed by a meteor or an earthquake, and obviously you're going to if things are going on, you're going to try to do something to help yourself and protect yourself. We're supposed to protect life, and that includes our own, right? So I wonder about that. There's also some other questions I have regarding the martyrdom. For example, if during Seal 6, where various tribes are protected, you know, all God's children are protected, but we also know that later on there will be more martyrs. We know that. I mean, when it talks about the two witnesses, for example, and we've had different ideas about two witnesses, but the point is they will die, right? They're going to be preaching and they will die. So they will be martyred for the faith as well. So I guess the question comes to mind, even though God seals his children for protection, he can obviously lift that seal of protection at any given point in time unto his ends, right? If for whatever reason, myself, maybe God will put me, and I'm not asking for this by any means, but maybe God, let's say, will put me in some kind of situation where I might be martyred. Well, to be martyred, he would have to remove that seal, right? Or else, if he doesn't remove the seal, how can I be martyred? So these are some questions that came to mind reading through this. Not that it matters a whole lot, because God is sovereign, right? He gives life, he takes away life. He can do what he pleases, all in accordance with his plans and unto working out, and for working out what he wants us to become, right? We have to go through what we go through in our time period in this world to suffer the sins, our own sins. We sin and we suffer the consequences of our own sins. We also suffer the consequences of our fathers, right? This whole idea of the sins of the fathers passed down through the third and fourth, if I'm not mistaken, generations. That's 80 years up to, right? We also suffer the sins of the world in general. Regardless whether, for example, this virus situation was created or not, it was born out of sin one way or the other, right? One way or the other, whether it was from eating unclean animals and whatever happens with all that, or whether it was created in a lab in China and all these kind of things, it's all sin. So we are suffering the sins of the world right now in this situation. One of my concerns lately, and I've been talking about this over the last few months, is that I honestly don't see what is happening right now as anywhere near what will happen when the sixth seal is open. Okay, I understand the concern. I understand the health advisements. You know, there's a lot of them out there, different ones and contradicting ones and all sorts of things. We know we have to have concern for especially our elderly and whatnot, but what I'm concerned about is to what degree we are, I don't want to say falling away, that's not the right term, and I don't even know how to put this, but what I'm seeing is a cancellation of so many feast sites over something that, in my opinion, again, I'm just looking at it from one point of view, seems like a drop in the bucket compared to what's going to happen. So here's my concern. My concern is this. If we have not figured out a way yet to have feasts or conduct feasts that would circumvent such orders by the state, concerns over facilities, who's going to pay, how can we afford to pay this without an organizational structure of some group, so to speak, you know, a church group that collects tithes and has enough money to pay for such things. I kind of feel like we've missed a boat somewhere. I kind of feel like that the churches of God in general may have not prepared fully in how to, let's say, organize and plan feasts the way that God might have us learn about over the next year or two. I don't know, it's just a concern I have about the way things are going. My primary concern, I guess, right now, effectively, is I feel like it's difficult to communicate about your feelings about anything without really greatly offending someone. And it almost doesn't matter what the issues are about. It's not just about doctrinal stuff. I'm just talking about, like, you know, concepts of why I might choose a certain health route and someone else might choose a different health route or that kind of thing. And it seems like no matter what you try to share about something you feel, let's say, is true versus something that isn't, it seems like a lot of people are taking it as criticism or condemnation when I honestly don't mean it that way. I'm trying to figure out ways of sharing things I still feel are true without throwing so many stumbling blocks before people. And I guess that I'm kind of feeling frustrated in that, and that even in, with brethren, it's getting to be slightly difficult to not upset someone when your intentions weren't that at all, you know, or somebody taking something totally different. Like, like for example, you might say that, you know, this thing over here seems to be a falsehood or whatever. And then somebody taking it, well, the virus is real. Yeah, I didn't say it wasn't real. I'll try to talk about this other thing over here. But it seems like we're so conditioned by mass media and the, I guess, the spirit of the world to just jump on board one of these group sides or whatever, the mob mentality thing. So yeah, let me open up the floor because that's all I had to present. I wasn't led to go in a lot of detail about these things. I kind of feel, after reading through these, I thought it was going to be more complicated to me. It seems pretty straightforward to me, reading through these seals and then looking into the trumpets. It doesn't seem all that complicated. So I guess why I say that is I have a fear generally of approaching prophecy, right? Subjects of prophecy, largely because I feel that there's so many different ways of looking at them that I have a hard time. Well, this is what I see, you know, right now. It might change in the future. I'm sure it will. Where if I look at law and applications of law, I've found that I have an easier time understanding it, and I thank God for that understanding. But all this prophecy stuff, what seemed very complicated, and I think it gets complicated when we start looking at timing or try to figure out when are these things going to happen. One of the group, 119 Ministries, who basically provided the impetus for this starting the study to begin with, on this part of the study, they kind of went off into a different focal point about this study. And they went into these ideas about, well, when might this happen on God's timetable? In other words, these different seals, trumpets, or whatever. When might these happen? Might they happen during the Days of Unleavened Bread, Passover? They got into this whole thing about that. Interesting studies, but I noticed with most every statement they made, it's like, well, we think this might be like this, or, you know, this is kind of what we're leaning towards, but we can't say definitely because there's all this stuff that you just can't really fully know. I mean, obviously we all see how God has important things happen around his holy day. So it makes a lot of sense, and there were some really good studies there. I wasn't led, I guess. I'm not as motivated to figure this out, to try to figure out when the things happen. I think there are other people that probably do a better job than I about doing such a thing. What I guess I'm most concerned about or looking at is that there is a different viewpoint about these seals especially being opened, and that looking from that viewpoint, trying to figure out, well, is there any credibility to this? Now I'm largely convinced that the seals up until at least the fifth could have easily been opened, it seems like, by Yeshua on the day of the first fruits when he rose to the Father and into heaven. I don't know, but it does lend credence. The scriptures seem to lend credence to this based on what we know and understand of the world and what's happened all this time. At any rate, okay, I'll open the floor up. Tom, you had a statement, and I hope you didn't fully forget it.
A couple of things that came to my mind as you were speaking. Through the years, and I've had fewer years than probably anybody here in the Church of God, per se, many people actually said that the tribulation was actually occurring then. And to go back to Dee's scripture reading here in Ecclesiastes in verse 15, here is an indication that these things can happen. It says, that which has been is now, and that which is to be has already been. All right? You see, in here, conditions can be such that people would suggest that the tribulation was already in effect and time periods set aside, God's timing and our timing. And then the second thing, verse 22, which is the last one, it says, therefore I perceive that there is nothing better that a man should do than to rejoice in his own works. And we should do that. We should do that. We're trying it. I'm sorry, we're trying, you're trying for real. For that is his portion. Here on earth, that's our portion. Mm-hmm. And then here comes the killer. For who can bring him to see what shall be after him? And here you have the great prognosticators and forecasters and prophesiers. Mm-hmm. See? And up to this point in time, they have all naturally they've all fallen short, basically because God says, "You don't know, and you're not ever going to know. I'll take care of it." Mm-hmm. Even Jesus told us that. Mm-hmm. All right. Keeping these things in mind, and there's something that floats around in the back of my mind that's very, very seldom talked about. Okay? I'm going to say this one word. Jubilee. Jubilee. The year of Jubilee. The 50th year. See, now that timing of that, as I understand it, has been lost because the physical Israel has been done away with. Now, the reason that that's important is the year of Jubilee, the requirements for that is all of the lands and all of the families and all of the people and the children were all restored to their original condition when the land was divided, when God gave them the land of milk and honey. Say, well, they can't determine that, so they've kind of lost it. Be that as it may, there have been some timings that I've seen the last 5 years or so about when the next year of Jubilee is going to be. And there's like a 5-year span of it between 2025 and 2030. I would not be surprised to see the tribulation start in relatively short order. And make no mistake, this Seal 6 is the one that I tell people about. I said, look, you start reading that, and the mountains move, God's going to shake this earth like a baby rattle.
That's right.
You better make up your mind to that. I mean, there is going to be no mistaking. What we're seeing now, these are conditions that we may have to endure because of men and their decisions. Mm-hmm. And their pomposity and chest beating and bye, whatever, all right? It's nothing. Nothing to what it's going to be.
I tend to agree.
You know.
Yeah, I've been saying it for a little while just because as we read.
That's the end of my
story. No, that's good. As we read on, you know, again, the sixth seal is pretty definite. I think we could all say with much certainty that has not happened yet. All the previous seals are every single one of the 1 through 5 are events that have happened since the fall of mankind, of humankind. It really have happened, but the sixth seal is different, and it's interesting to look at it that way because I never really had looked at it that way. And yes, I've seen the different viewpoints about Jubilee. There's all sorts of, you know, studies out there, some claiming it starts as early as maybe even this year. I don't know. I don't remember. There's some different ones out there. I think it's interesting that God allowed the Jubilee to be forgotten to whatever degree, and I think it's because of this particular reason that no man knows the hour. So God made sure that no one's going to be able to count this out and figure it out. It just ain't going to happen.
If it wasn't hidden, there would be people out there, like, it would become an icon or they'd idolize it, and they'd be so certain that's
when it, so we could just sin, and then repent when it comes to that time, which God, of course, in Isaiah, in a couple spots, he slams ancient Israel for the feasts and the holy days they were keeping because they weren't doing it correctly. They were doing it in a way to where yearly they would come and do a feast, like atonement or whatever, but the rest of the year they don't act the way they should be acting. They're not visiting the widows and the fatherless and all this sort of stuff. So there's this viewpoint of trying to figure out, well, at what time period are all these things going to start? But there's this other viewpoint, which is what I like about a lot of these studies, is that they're not looking at it so much as, well, what year is this going to happen, so much as when in accordance with God's holy days is going to happen, which to me is more interesting of a study. Because then we see the relationship, we see something, a new level maybe of understanding and revelation about God's holy days that maybe we hadn't seen exactly the same way as before. And so I really think it is interesting to study the event, the prophetic events, more so from that point of view and how it relates to God's plan, God's yearly cycle going on of his moads, his appointed times, than it is to try to figure out, well, what year is all this going to happen? Because as Christ said himself, forget it, you're not going to figure it out. You know, go ahead.
He gave us the signs.
none of us know exactly how it's going to play out. God's Sabbaths and holy days show us, they symbolize his plan for mankind. So what are we told to do? Watch and pray. And just have faith that he's in control.
Yeah.
Those of us that know the truth, we'll know.
Yeah.
When it comes, we'll know.
Well, I think now looking at it, to me now this way, looking at the sixth seal seemed like to me is going to be the big we'll know. That's before all that takes place. To me, it sounds like the earth being tilted on its axis would cause that sort of thing. I mean, I've read in the past various scientific presuppositions of what might happen if either the earth axes shift too far on their tilt, because it wobbles all the time anyway. But the point is, if it goes too far, or not just the axis of the actual physical earth, but the magnetic poles, if those shift, weird things can happen. So, you know, it's, and the thing is to me is, what you could possibly do, you can't save yourself if that happens. If you're in a zone that's going down, guess what? See, you're going down. I mean, unless God somehow miraculously seals and protects you, which is what I'm seeing is what's going on there.
You're gonna let us go to sleep, and that'll be our place of safety until yep. such time that we're resurrected.
Yep.
Or he'll protect us.
There is a cat in every soul, some brightly burning, some dark and cold. There is a spirit who brings a fire, ignites a candle, and makes his home. Carry your candle, run to the darkness, seek out the helpless, confused and torn, and hold out your candle for all to see it. Take your candle and go light your world. Take your candle and go light your world. Frustrated brother, see how he's tried to light his own candle some other way. See now your sister, she's been robbed and lied to, still holds a candle without a flame. So carry your candle, run to darkness, seek out the lonely, the tired and worn, and hold out your candle for all to see it. Take your candle and go light your world. Take your candle and go light your world. Hearts are blazing, so let's raise our candles and light up the sky. Bring to our Father in the name of Jesus, makes us a beacon in darkest time. Carry your candle, run to the darkness, seek out the hope. And pour and hold out your candle for all to see it. Take your candle and go light your world. Take your candle and go
go light your world. Carry your candle, run to the darkness, seek out the helpless, confused and torn, and hold out your candle for all to see it. Take your candle and go light your world. Take your candle and go light your world.